The colonization and eventual terraforming of Mars has been a roller coaster of a question. It's possible, but a tall order for sure. Originally, the idea seemed straightforward. Melt Mars's frozen oceans, beef up its atmosphere, and eventually, over thousands of years, you may end up with something at least somewhat like Earth. That at least wouldn't immediately kill you if your spacesuit ruptured. Oxygenating its atmosphere, however, would most efficiently require life. And if you had some sort of algae that Mars could be made hospitable to, or a GMO that can live there, you could oxygenate the atmosphere. But that process, as it was being seen, would take a very long time, potentially millions of years, contingent on the realities and unknowns of doing that. But oxygenation would happen faster than it did on Earth in ideal circumstances, because Mars is mostly already rusted. There would not be much of an oxygen sink there. Unlike early Earth, where the iron oxidation process of Earth's surface iron ate up the oxygen early on and ceased being a major sink. But any way you look at it, the oxygenation of the Martian atmosphere is a long-term proposition. Humans as we are right now from Earth will not breathe that atmosphere for a very, very long time. That said, there is a rather controversial question of not only improving Mars for habitation, but improving humans to more easily inhabit Mars. Critics of Mars colonization plans, such as those of SpaceX, often point out that humans are just not very suitable for the Martian environment. We die there instantly without a spacesuit. There's no oxygen, and much of that planet's surface is bitterly cold. It's true, we do not make good Martians as we are right now. And there are a number of other concerns, such as should anyone try to reproduce on Mars? That's a big one because the chances of it going wrong are high. We evolved to be born on this planet, and sometimes even that doesn't go according to plan. But that would be worse on Mars. Then there's the perchlorate soil. It's not suitable for farming, but that soil can be washed. Those are legitimate concerns, but there's one area where I do not think the criticism is warranted, and that's whether anyone will want to go to Mars. This is a common argument against it. Who would want to live in a dome or habitat on a hostile world, with few, if any, of the creature comforts of Earth? The answer is simple. The same type of people that would risk death trying to climb Mount Everest, which right now is about 600 to 800 people per year, and is an entire cottage industry in that area of Nepal. People will go to Mars just because it's there, and some will live there, at least for a time, if they can. Often detractors of Mars colonization forget those kinds of people exist. I am not one of them. I like my creature comforts too much, and I am not getting on a rocket. Too much bother and too much time away from my easy chair, books, and PlayStation controller. But herein is a question. Can you make a human, a genetically altered human, to be better suited for Mars? The answer is yes. There is no reason you couldn't as long as you have advanced enough genetics, which we aren't there yet. And won't be for quite a while. But eventually, sure, why not? And I actually did an interview on this very subject with journalist George Dvorsky on Event Horizon, link in the description below, about 5 years ago. This creates some rather unpleasant scenarios that have been explored in science fiction, where you have to ask the question, at what point would modified Martians no longer be members of Homo sapiens, but so different that they can be classed as a new species? You can imagine all sorts of horror story scenarios there, and indeed I explored one in Supermind, that of augmented and unaugmented people. Not the least of these scenarios are a group of modified humans that can live on Mars to some extent anyway, but not be able to live on Earth. Think people stuck on Mars, a planet they did not evolve on, rather they were artificially evolved to live on it. Being born on that world but unable to go to Earth might make some folks cranky on Mars. But back to colonization, because some form of it does appear to be on the table. And now it can be done much more efficiently and in much shorter time than has been envisioned in the past. Indeed, it could happen over the next few decades, or not. Though I think we will see some kind of a human visit to the Red Planet, if only a scientific expedition. But it's difficult to envision that we won't someday colonize Mars, if we survive as a technological species, for centuries more or longer. Mars in some capacity will be home for someone in the future, if we keep on the path that we are. But then there's the idea of melting all the locked up water on Mars. There are many plans to do this, including using nuclear bombs to melt it. But the profile of water and frozen carbon dioxide on Mars has changed as we understand that planet better, and those older ideas of unleashing the water have fallen to the wayside. The preferred methods now are more technological. One idea is by Robin Wordsworth and colleagues, linked to these papers below, that involves using transparent silica aerogel just above the surface to locally warm areas of Mars. Another idea by Edwin, Kite and colleagues involves releasing microscopic iron rods into the Martian atmosphere. Mars has a lot of iron, to warm it up that way. Interestingly, warming Mars with the iron nanorods would actually reduce the time needed very dramatically, to the tune of 5,000 times faster than any other way, meaning we could melt Mars and it would start forming oceans again in less than a year if the production of the rods were very aggressive. And potential issues like rods raining out as the water cycle on Mars restarted would need to be addressed. It would take a lot of iron, but Mars is red because it has a lot of iron, and those rods and aerogels could be manufactured on Mars. Another concern is most other means of terraforming that planet require materials to be sent from Earth, which isn't very viable when you need enough CFCs to dramatically warm a planet to the degree that you would need with Mars. More CFCs than what we produce, actually. But melting Mars is only the first of a series of problems to solve in order to make it something close to habitable. Another is that Mars has very, very low atmospheric pressure, less than 1% of what Earth has. And while that can be raised somewhat with water vapor and oxygen potentially created by transplanted algae, it won't get Mars to Earth's pressures, at least not for a very long time. And it's unclear what could be done there, or what minimum pressure you would need to achieve. Then you need Mars to hold onto its atmosphere as it thickens. But this is less of a problem because it takes a very, very long time to strip a planetary atmosphere where Mars is. So once you had it, you would need to maintenance the changed atmosphere, but not that much over short intervals. So regular maintenance done diligently would solve the problem. But then there is one glaring problem with Mars that may at first glance seem insurmountable. That planet has no magnetic field. That's when Mars lost its atmosphere, and indeed continues to lose its atmosphere. Today the loss is partly offset by volcanic outgassing from Mars's interior, but it's still overall hemorrhaging its atmosphere because it has no protection from the solar wind. So to fix this problem and also gain the other benefits of magnetic fields, the best option is to give one to Mars. Normally you'd think giving a planet a magnetic field would be beyond difficult, actually functionally impossible without somehow restarting the planet's internal dynamo to generate an internally produced magnetic field, if that's even possible with a planet of Mars's age. That's just not going to happen. And if you did somehow make it work, what kind of magnetic field would you get? Would it be strong enough to serve the purpose that it does on Earth? How do you keep the dynamo from shutting down again, and so on? That leaves only one other option, an artificial magnetic field, and it's far easier than you think to do. In a paper by Jim Green and colleagues, link in the description below, along with links to my interviews with Dr. Green, who is also NASA chief scientist, they detail a plan to straightforwardly equip Mars with an artificially generated magnetic field, or more accurately, a shield. The idea goes like this. You place a magnetic dipole, rather a spacecraft acting as one, at the L1 Lagrange point of Mars. There are many ways to have a spacecraft generate a magnetic dipole field, but one interesting way is an inflatable structure generating a 1 or 2 Tesla field. Given its distance at L1 from Mars, it should be able to shield all of Mars while having a relatively small-sized field. Voila! In short, a shield, and Mars effectively gains a magnetic field from an inexpensive spacecraft we could build right now. No future technology needed here, we already have it. But because Mars is still outgassing, if you protect the atmosphere with the magnetic shield, then that would contribute to thickening the atmosphere. And you have the frozen carbon dioxide at Mars's poles that would enter and warm the atmosphere as it melts. Then the water ice melts, perhaps with the help of iron nanorods to speed the process up. Mars no longer has as much water as it did when it had oceans, but the researchers calculated that it could end up with about 1/7 of what Mars originally had in its new oceans. That's a lot of water. Mars would be a partial ocean world again, potentially very rapidly, though not as dramatic as Earth's oceans. But it would make Mars actually start to resemble Earth in a sort of spooky, non-identical twin sort of way. Earth's Mr. Spock with a beard. Still, regardless, it would be a second blue jewel. With its technological magnetic shield in place, Mars would gain atmospheric pressure, though it's not clear just how much, from a thickened atmosphere. Warmer temperatures comparable to Earth with the nanorods, and potentially oxygen coming from its oceans, courtesy of transplanted Earth life, nudging it much closer to Earth-like conditions. It probably won't ever truly be another Earth, but it may become a place where humans can at least semi-comfortably live and self-sustain, and at least turn that planet into a place where plants can easily live. And it has to be said that there is a huge technosignature here, a glaring one that anyone within a few hundred light years may well see. I've mentioned it before, the impossible planet. And Mars would very quickly start looking like something it should not be, given its size. Planets do not change like that in nature. And with plants comes biosignatures. Aliens would see the oxygenated atmosphere of Mars, and even the vegetative red edge might come on the table, where plants become highly reflective in infrared. In short, the aliens would see what we did there. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently getting long in the tooth as a YouTuber. That Dvorsky interview was conducted 5 years ago, and it really does not feel like I've been hosting Event Horizon that long. Nor does it feel like nearly 9 years since I started this channel. Time flies when you're having fun, it really does, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations of the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.